Father. For all of us, it's a joy to be here in the house of prayer with you. We appreciate so much your presence here. We appreciate so much your holy guidance. In the times like these, when the whole entire world is in shock and in confusion and in distress and in depression, only here, dear Lord, we can find peace, joy, assurance, and your hope, which you are providing for each one of us here. Dear Lord, we would like to be your followers today. We would like to be your students. We would like to open your word. We would like to be nourished, and we would like to give you glory. Bless all our musicians today and all the ministerial saints. Bless our guests today and help us to worship you from the bottom of our hearts. We are praising you, dear Lord, and we are praying in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, church family. I'd like to read our Bible text for today, found in the book of Hebrews, chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Hebrews, chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. May this holy word of God be planted in our hearts.
It's time to seek the Lord in prayer, and please join me as we kneel in prayer. our loving Father in heaven, we praise your name, O Father. We thank you for this beautiful Sabbath morning that you have given us to come and worship you. Oh Lord, here we are, your people, kneeling down before you with a congregation for the time. We ask you, O Father, that you forgive our sins that we have committed against thee, that we may be acceptable in thy sight. If anyone who is sick today, O Father, we ask you to heal those brothers and sisters and bless each one of us in this church, the leader, our leaders, and our members alike. We all also remember, O Father, the leaders in this world. We are living, we know that we are living this world. The signs that you have spoken to us before your coming, they're all happening. So help us, O Father, to lift up our heads and concentrate our lives to you. O Father, bless our pastor as he speak to us your word. Open our hearts and may your Holy Spirit touch us our heart that we may be able to hear them. Father, we know that your coming is very soon. Help us, oh Father. We can do anything. It's our longing, Lord, to be connected with you all the time. So help us as we keep waiting for your coming. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, Church.
Happy Sabbath,
Church.
Happy Sabbath.
Amen. We all agree that we are all stewardship of God's treasure. Yes. And I praise God that He continually to bless us. And God requires each and every one of us to return 10% of our earnings. But there's a passage in the book of Mark, if you open your Bible. Mark chapter 12, verse 42. And it says, "Then one poor widow came and threw in two mites, which made abundance." And Christ is speaking that this poor widow threw everything she has in the treasury of God's of God. And in the book of Testimonies for the Church, volume 4, it says, "If all the tithes of our people flowed in the treasury of the Lord as they should, such blessings would be received that gifts and offerings for sacred purposes would be multiplied tenfold. And thus the channel between God and man would keep open." We all know that the purpose of our tithes and our offering is to support the ministry. That we, all nations, and soon it will come, shall we all bow our heads. Our loving Heavenly Father, Lord, we are thankful for this Sabbath. Thank you, Lord, for all the blessings that you bestow upon us. And now, Lord, I ask that you please bless the tithes and offerings that we give today for your glory and not our glory, Lord. And thank you, Lord, for using us as a channel of your treasure to reach out those who are looking for you, Lord, searching for the truth. And I pray that you please bless each and every one of us as we continue to work for you, Lord. I ask all these things in the loving name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Marriage is between a man and a woman, And you don't lie with anyone else besides your husband, your wife. So there's a couple of ways you can do that, but it's remembering not to commit adultery. Number eight is you don't steal. And again, there's a couple of ways you can do this one. You have three on one hand, five on another hand. Don't steal. Or in some places, if you steal, they can cut off your fingers or your hand. So you go like this. Is you don't give false testimony, or you don't bear false witness. You want to make sure you're always telling the truth. So when you go to court, you have to lay up one hand,
my faithful Father.
Praise be to the Lord for His amazing grace. Thank you so much for the beautiful children story. And for the opportunity to praise the name of Jesus this morning. The title of our sermon today is Never Follow. What does it mean actually? Just whom should we not follow? We are living in the world which are promoting for us to never follow but always lead. Many people in our days experiencing confusion, hopelessness. People are facing a crisis of leadership in the United States. And the whole entire world is in shock. What is really going on? It's quite interesting to notice that Sabbath school lesson which we studied for this week is entitled Crisis of Leadership. Wonder what this Sabbath school has been actually prepared at least a few years ago. And I personally know Professor Roy King. I had the privilege to talk to him while I was at Andrews University. And the Lord moved him by His Holy Spirit to write this lesson entitled for the people to see what is going to be on January 2021. On the week from 2nd to 8th, when he entitled Crisis of Leadership. It's quite important for us to see what the Lord is in control and He knows what's going to be in the future. It's important for us to remember what the Lord knew what you are going to be here in this church this morning, because the Lord is in control of everything that's happening around the world. Because it's so easy for us to fall into depression and stress and wonder what is really happening, because we are under the pressure of crisis. But the Lord is giving us hope. And He is explaining to us right from the pages of the Bible in the way like where there is no vision, what is going to happen to people. People will perish. But then keep it the law, happy seed. And Carissa was doing today children's story. I said, praise be the Lord. I had no idea she's going to talk about Ten Commandments. But the Holy Spirit guided you and was leading all of us here to be prepared and open-minded for the special guidance and vision from the Lord. Let us pray. Merciful Heavenly Father, the whole world is in crisis right now. But we need your guidance, dear Lord. We need your help. Because in order for us to be a great leader here in this earth, we all need to learn, we all must learn how to follow you, our great leader, our great master, our God. Bless us today as we will open your word and study. Let it be all for your glory, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
I was reading a story recently about a little boy who had been hospitalized after being badly burned. The school system in the little town developed a program to help children to keep up with the schoolwork if they needed to spend extensive time in the hospital. It means one special education teacher went to see the boy this afternoon, and no one had mentioned to him that this boy has actually been very badly injured. He'd been quite burned, and he was in great pain. When she came to his room, she got shocked, and she was upset at the sight of the boy. She stammered and told him, with quite a hesitation in your words,
have been sent by your school to help you with nouns and adverbs. When she left, she felt she had not accomplished very much at all. But the next day, a nurse asked her, "What did you do to that boy?" And the teacher felt that she must have done something wrong and began to apologize. No, said the nurse. I don't know if you understand what I mean here, but at least I'm trying to tell you about this boy. He quite changed since yesterday. His whole attitude has changed. He is fighting back for life now, because it seems like he decided to live again. 2 weeks before, as we know, he was absolutely dying. But now, since yesterday, he's quite a different person. Everything changed quite quickly as they observed the boy. But the boy came to the simple realization after the visit of a special teacher. He said, "They will never send a teacher to work on nouns and adverbs with a dying boy, would they?" But this bedridden child needed more than anything else. He needed hope in his life. And in times like this, we all need hope. And in times like this, we need Jesus. And in times like this, we need to focus on our great leader, who is saying to all of us, right in the middle of the Bible, "Don't put your confidence in men, put your confidence in God." Some of you know, according to the English version of the Bible, the Psalm 118 verse 8, it says these particular words. It's a central passage of the Bible. Don't put confidence in men, because we are all living right now in a time when all world is shaking. But hope powerfully motivates us to look forward to the day which is going to be after tomorrow. It paints the future in the bright colors rather than just dark shadows. And this is why we have this special text from the Bible that Paul is saying to the young Timothy the following words, where he starts, mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. Not just regular times, it will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, even though those people will be unholy completely, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of good, but treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. Heavy in the form of godliness, but denying its power. Have nothing to do with such people. What Paul the Apostle is trying to tell you and me this morning, have nothing to do with such people. You know why? Because in order for us to be a great leader on earth, we simply need to learn how to follow first. But it seems like we are living in the times when no one wants to follow. Everybody wants to be a great leader. And this is what is happening. But the Bible is filled with hope and coded messages. And a special message to you and me this morning, what we have a great leader. And it's engraved, it's encrafted in the Bible, the message to all of us. What when we are reading the book of the Bible, we see how the Lord was leading the Israelites from Egypt to the promised land. Read that Israelites built their first church on the planet Earth. They call it tabernacle. Because it was a tent, tabernacle. And they built their first church. But it's interesting how the church operated. On the day the tabernacle, the tent of the covenant law was set up, the cloud covered up. From evening till morning, the cloud above the tabernacle looked like fire. And I would like for the young people right now to pay attention to the word, as I will use the word cloud. And people, if you will count how many times I will say the word cloud during this little sermon, I wanted to give you a gift. Because I know how many times I will pronounce according to the script, although, but at least the closest number, you will receive the gift, the word cloud. That's how actually it's continued to be. The cloud covered up, and at night it looked like a fire. Whenever the cloud lifted from above the tent, the Israelites set out. Whenever the cloud settled, the Israelites encamped. Whether the cloud stayed over the tabernacles for 2 days, or a month, or a year, the Israelites will remain in camp and not set out. But when it lifted, they will set out. At the Lord's command, they encamped. At the Lord's command, they set out. They obeyed the Lord's order. What a time. Do you wish to be in a time like this? And you can see it clear. And then you can hear the clear, the voice of the Lord. And the Lord will tell you and me, come on, go out. So, what do we learn from this lesson, from the text which we just read? We learn how the people of Israel have been trained by God Himself just to follow. Just to follow. Follow the leader. And the cloud was covered the whole day. And they obeyed religiously. In our modern years, this strange, in best, it seemed naive. And in worst, it seems like so destructive. We will be followers? Can that even be? As we know, in auto news, Audi, great automobile company, hired an advertising agency, McKinsey, for some help in advertising. They wanted to improve their selling. And from 2002 until 2010, it's amazing longevity of the great success accrued to the Audi company. The tagline was quite clear. Never follow. Just never follow. It's quite interesting. It's not only happened to the automobile companies, but what about the musicians, artists, and sport figures promoted the idea, never follow, but just to lead. Never follow. It's interesting what the business and the leadership professor Barbara Kellerman at Harvard University decided to make a little research and find out about the tagline which Audi company used it, never follow. And she started to do a research about this tagline. And this is what she says. The tagline, never follow, take into a fear rooted deep in the American psyche. It reflected our aversion to being, or to be seen as being, or to be seen as being one among in a meek and mindless herd. And she continues, the word never says it all. Never. It says plainly, but there is no conceivable circumstances under which we should fall so low as to fall into just the line with all the others. From Harvard University, she learned that the word follower was considered as to be as an insult to the American society. The word follower. It's interesting to notice that many companies are still promoting follow the leader because he's on the Honda. Follow the leader. Parents want their children to grow up to be leaders, to be in the front lines. No one wants to be the actual follower. It's interesting what so many books have been written in our culture about leadership, leadership seminars, coaching seminars to become the best possible leaders. As you heard last Sabbath, my nephew Mark was preaching here from this pulpit. He preached about the leadership and how the leader Jesus took the towel into his hands, knelt down, and washed the disciples' feet. This is what the main tab which he used for the leadership. This is where leadership starts, when you will humble yourself. Actually, I tried to Google it, information about the seminars and leadership, and I found out that we are living in a culture where leadership seminars, leadership promoting is everywhere throughout the whole entire media and internet providers. Actually, even I went and Googled the term PhD in leadership, and you see what I found out about it? More than 270 million results. Programs across the United States and around the world attended the following: world-class university in PhD and leadership. I tried to Google PhD in following, and I couldn't find one result. PhD in following, there is no results. And I felt, maybe here at the Kahului Church, we need to promote the special timeline for the whole entire world and here in Hawaii. What we are creating followers in 2021. Come to Kahului SDA Church, we will teach you how to follow. Other places you will become a great leader, but right here only in Kahului you will learn how to follow. Because you see, in order for you to become a great leader, we need to learn from the simple stuff. We need to learn directly from Jesus Christ how to follow. How to follow our Jesus, how to follow our great leader. Actually, it's quite interesting to notice what Jesus, when he called his disciples, he never asked them to leave. More than 30 times, only alone in the New Testament, it says more than 30 times, follow me, follow me, follow me. He never asked them, go and lead, go and be a leader. No, he said just to follow me. I want to share with you a little discovery which been made by Rabbi Michael Westerlander, and actually a brilliant Czechoslovakian Jewish scholar who was living between the World War I and World War II, and he made discoveries in his study of the Hebrew text, which is actually a rediscovery of the ancient rabbis they knew long time before, the special script in the Bible. It's interesting how the word Torah been encrypted right here in the biblical text. And not only that, he found those many coded messages in the Bible. Because Torah is the book of from Genesis until Deuteronomy. As we are looking at the opening pages, we realize that the Hebrew text is going from right to left. Yes? And we should understand what languages on those days, the text go from right to left, and actually languages go toward Jerusalem, continues the same pattern. And the west of Jerusalem, they were writing from the west of Jerusalem, they were writing from left to right. It's like Greek, English, Russian, Latin. But those who were writing from the eastern side of Jerusalem, they were all writing from right to left. Like Hebrew, Aramaic, Sanskrit, and some others. I think it will be nice to see right now a colorful description right in the Bible with four letters. As we will look simply in some of the five books of Torah. And I would like for you to pay attention, because I use this slide from my original source. And this is what it says over here, but in the book of Torah, if you go just to the book of Genesis, first page, open the page and look at the words here, you will come to the first letter, Tav. Count 49 letters and come to the one. which operates of sort of like O. And count 49 letters, and you will come to the letter Rash. And again, count 49 letters, and again, you will come to the letter K. And this is what you will read after that. It will show you what you found those four letters, 49 letters in interval, and you will read word Torah, which will be written from right to left in Hebrew. T-O-R-A. With the spelling of the English, we are saying in our language nowadays, Torah. It's quite interesting if you're using those 49 letters, and it's, you will say it's quite a good coincidence, it's nice, it's in the book of Genesis. But if you go to the book of Exodus, the first page, and it's still exactly the same, it's, you'll find the first letter T, Tor, and after that you will go on 49 letters, and it's exactly in the same sequence, you'll find the actual word Tor. And people are wondering, wow, it's quite interesting. Maybe if you will count those 49 letters apart and see what is really obviously, it's not just happened by accident or coincidence, it simply is like by design in the Bible. And we are going to the book of Exodus, and we are checking now the book of Leviticus, and it seems like there is nothing in the book of Leviticus. And you say, wow. Yeah, it's not working for Leviticus. Let's go to Book of Numbers. And you're checking the Book of Numbers. And it's strange things happen. You will find out what it starts with actual hey, Rash, of and Tor. And it will show you the word Torah the back way, and the opposite way. And maybe you will look at this and discover and say, should it be a coincidence in the book of Numbers? And you look in the book of Deuteronomy, first page, you count in those 49 letters, and it's happened exactly the same, but the Torah is written in the opposite way, compare the book of Genesis and Exodus. It's interesting what we found right in the Bible that coded message. We're reading the Bible and saying, yes, it's just for some, it's just plain book, it's another literature on the shelf. But honestly, my dear beloved, book is inspired by God Himself. It's not just a book. It's a big book of life for presenting to you and me the message about our Savior. And you found this information in the book of Genesis and the book of Exodus. You'll find the opposite way in the book of Torah, the book of Numbers and Deuteronomy. You see, what is happening in the book of Leviticus? Why I can't find anything in Leviticus? But in Leviticus, it's working only slightly in a different way. You need to go to the book of Leviticus, and over the time, Rabbi were studying and counting and searching until the Lord provided for them to find out. But in the book of Leviticus, you will find only if you count seven letters, not 49, but seven letters. And it starts with your, the hey, wow, and again, hey. And you will count to the letter Yahweh. Yes, right in the middle of the Leviticus, right in the first page of Leviticus. It seems like the book of Genesis and Exodus is pointing toward Leviticus, even with the writing of the word from right to left, according to what's seen here on the screen. And Numbers and Deuteronomy pointing back to the Leviticus again, in an amazing way. It's quite obvious what we see, what the Lord wanted to provide for us, amazing creativity of God to show what every single page, every single letter in the Bible, showing us the direction to our great leader, Yahweh, the Lord Jesus Christ. It's interesting to notice what Jesus shared with his followers. And he will open the Bibles in the book of John chapter 8. You will find a story. You will find a story of the scribes and the Pharisees brought to Jesus a woman.
she's been talking about John chapter 8. And they accused him. And they placed her in front of Jesus and they asked him, what should we do? Should we use our stones and just kill you right away, right here? But Jesus told them, he who without sin among you, let him throw a stone here first. My dear beloved, it's easy for us in our days to throw the stone to what is happening in the world, to the leaders who are proud. It's much harder to go to our Father. Much harder. Because it's easier for us to accuse the boy thinkers. But what is happening right in the same chapter, chapter 8, because Jesus continued conversations with the actual Pharisees. And this is what actually happened. The conversation continues, and then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Jesus proposed to them this line, and they answered to him. And they said, we are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. They forgot what they've been slaves for 400 years in Egypt. And now they're saying, we have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean? What, you will set us free? Who are you, Jesus? And now they're questioning the authority of Jesus. And it continues on. And in the following text, as you will read verse 41, this is how they answered. And they said, we are not illegitimate children. They protested, questioning Jesus. Who are you, Jesus? Where is your authority? How can you say this? Well, we've been slaves, and we are not illegitimate children. We have our father Abraham. God himself is our father. And who are you, Jesus? It seems like quite obviously in this chapter, John the Revelator, John the disciple of Jesus, is trying to tell you and me what they shake the foundation. And they question the actual existence of Jesus. And they only question even Jesus with his illegitimate child birth. They actually pointing to Jesus what he came into this world illegitimately. And Jesus couldn't hold his breath anymore. And he said the following words. Very truly I tell you, according to John 8, 28, very truly I tell you, before Abraham was, I am. At that moment, Jesus used the word Yahweh. He said, Yahweh is standing in your presence. Right now, Yahweh is here. Just because of that name, they considered what he blasphemed. But he used the name of God and called himself as God, they crucified him. Just because when he pronounced himself as Yahweh. God's brief history with the events of Jesus' birth, death, and resurrection. This is the pattern. This is the foundation. And this is all what we believe. Because it's all about Jesus. Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Then Jesus said to his disciples, whoever wants to be my disciple, you must deny themselves and take up the cross and do what?
Follow
me. He never asked them to lead. He simply asked to follow him. They were not just the great 12 leaders. They were 12 followers, 12 learners. They'll be able to teach the others how to follow Jesus. How to follow the one who is the great Yahweh on a planet Earth, came to save the world in a time of destruction and trouble. If you see anyone saying, I'm the leader, it's a myth. Nobody leads unless you come before anybody else and you created everything. You are, by definition, following somebody. You're looking at the artwork, and it's someone else's production. We are in this building right now, it's someone else's production. You arrive in the car, it's someone else's production. Books and films and everything what is around us, we are following
And let me tell you this morning who we really are. We are all followers. But the main question, whom do we follow? Whom do I follow? This is the main question why I'm here today. Because I would like to follow the leader. I would like to follow the only one who really surrendered his life for me. This is what Sister White is writing. Christ made complete sacrifice on our behalf when he gave himself as an offering for sin. And he asked us to give ourselves entirely to him. Entirely. Nothing else should be whole. He asked with a whole heart. He will accept nothing less than in divided affections. God is a spirit, and that they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Entirely surrender your life into the hands of Jesus. The Bible says, both the followers of the Lord Jesus Christ will be quite obvious according to the book of Revelation. It says, they follow the Lamb wherever he goes. They were purchased from among mankind and offered as the first fruit to God and the Lamb. These 144 virgins are pure. They follow the Lamb wherever he goes. They were brought from among the humanity as the first ones offered to God and to the Lamb. Knowing the will of God is not primarily about what's happening in the world. But the main question, are you following the right leader? Whom are you following? You see, the issue with followers, it sometimes could be embarrassment here in this world when you will promote this idea. Come over, we will teach you how to follow. But at the same time, it's quite a bad reaction if you're following a wrong person. If you're following the wrong system. If you're following the wrong influence which has been bombarded by advertising in the world and it's been already inserted into your mind. Let's look open-mindedly what's really happening in the world now. May the Lord help our church and all of you to see what we are living in the last days. And we really need to turn around and start to follow our great leader who is coming. And who is coming very soon because he knows the plans about you. And I would like all of you to read this from the screen right now together. Because it says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." May God reach and bless you as you look forward to the special day because you are not alone. There are many, many people already being surrounded under the influence of the Holy Spirit, and they are like a cloud following only the right leader. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by the great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which easily ensnares us. This is our text for today. Who is ensnaring us? Who is that serpent who is ensnaring us? Choose the right leader. Follow the right leader of faith. What a day is going to be when we will see Jesus on the clouds. What a day is going to be when we will see him with his holy angels. And so many angels are going to surround him, but we will see the whole entire procession as a huge cloud. Which will come near and near. At a time when no one will expect it, Jesus will return. The heavens are rolled together as a scroll, the earth trembles before him, and every mountain and island is moved out of its place. There is no security on the islands either, according to the Bible. Soon there appears in the east a small black cloud, about the half the size of a man's palm. And this is what it says, "Look! He is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him." Those who heard the name Yahweh. They will see Jesus and the clouds with the holy angels. I invite you today to follow Jesus. I invite you today to completely surrender your life and look at your life. Look at your plans. Look at your desires. Look where are you today. And pray for your family. Pray for your children. Join the 10 days of prayer sessions. And think about the reality. Who is trying to leave this world now? About who is in control? I really would like to be in control of my Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus Christ. And if it's true to you, please raise your hand and say, I would like to follow Jesus, my Yahweh, my Savior, my Redeemer. May God bless you. Let us pray. And pray deeply in your heart as well. Oh, Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And forgive. Give us today our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we also forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation. Yes, Lord. Lead us not into temptation. But deliver us from the evil one. Deliver us, O Lord, and bless everyone here, and help us to follow you, our Yahweh, our Redeemer, our Savior.
I pray all these things in Christ's name.